of the property that do not apply generally to other property in the same zone or neighborhood. 3. That the granting of the variance will not be materially detrimental to the public welfare or injurious to the property or improvements in such zone or neighborhood in which the property is located. And 4. That the granting of the variance will not be contrary to the objectives of the ordinance. If the evidence presented in the application and at the hearing meets the criteria just described, then the zoning administrator can either approve or impose conditions for approval on the case in question. If the findings of fact are not evident, then the request will be denied. Notification for this hearing was accomplished by the use of public notices, which were mailed to property owners located within 500 feet of the subject property, physically posted on the site in question, and placed in the local newspaper. The hearing will proceed as follows. I will read the description of the application or the request, and then read reports received from other city departments and other letters or communications from interested parties. The case planner will make a brief overview or presentation of the case and make a recommendation. The applicant will be asked to come forward, stating both name and address, and will be asked to present the case within a 15-minute time limit. Others in support of or in opposition to the application and any interested parties will be asked to come forward to speak. Again, clearly stating both name and address within a 3-minute time limit. Lastly, the applicant will be given the opportunity to make closing comments if desired in response to testimonies given by preceding speakers within a 5-minute time limit. The hearing will be closed and the case taken under submission. After the hearing, the decision will be prepared in writing and will be in the form of a letter sent to the applicant and to all persons who responded to the public notice, either by speaking at this hearing or by submitting written responses and have provided their name and mailing address. I would like to emphasize that the date of the decision will be the date appearing on the letter. Under the appeal provisions of Title 30, Chapter 30 of the Glendale Municipal Code, the decision may be appealed to the Planning Commission within 15 days of the date of the decision. Anyone wishing to appeal may obtain forms and brochures on the procedures from Building and Safety Section, Permit Services Center, located on the same floor of this building. If you wish to speak, please write your name and address on one of these speaker forms, which have been provided by the front door, and submit it to our assistant. I would like to also inform everyone that the official proceedings of the zoning administrator's hearing are recorded on tape as part of public record. Our first case is variance 2009-019. Location is 2256 Hollister Terrace. This case was continued from the September 30th public hearing. Applicant is Garo Nazarian. Owner is Kosh Karyan Gevorg. Case planner is Jale Kiazand. This is an application for a variance to allow the legalization of a 20-foot, 2-inch high, 192-square-foot covered outdoor kitchen to be located on the interior property line, located at 2256 Hollister Terrace, in the R1R, Restricted Residential Zone, Floor Area District 2, described as easterly one-half of Lot 7, Tract Number 6324. And let me just quickly go through some of the comments. Is Alison Drucker here? No? Okay. I have a letter from this neighbor. Basically in opposition to the application, and I think she is the next door neighbor. Okay. Letter from another neighbor at 2256 Hollister Terrace. Basically, they didn't say if they were in opposition or in support, but they were concerned about the height of the outdoor kitchen and that it is on the property line, which is in violation of city requirements. 2260 Hollister. Another letter from a neighbor, 2248 Hollister Terrace. Again, expressing concern about the kitchen, the height, proximity to the property line, and I guess fire issues. 2245 Hollister. This one is in opposition to the application. Again, about the encroachment and privacy issue and adjacent to the property line. An email from neighbors on 2268 Hollister Terrace. Basically in opposition of the illegal construction. Another neighbor on 2253 Hollister Terrace in opposition of the application. And from fire prevention, this is a high fire hazard area, and the code requirements will be their CBC Chapter 7-8 type of construction. Neighborhood services. So the property has a code enforcement case since December of 2008, which resulted in this variance applications. And if variance approval is granted, they wanted all violations to be remedied. Their major concern is that the gazebo is located right along the westerly property line, and that the roof seems to be 12 inches from the post. Therefore, the drainage from the roof of the gazebo is partially being discharged onto the same adjoining property, which is unacceptable. So no drainage from the gazebo shall be allowed to drain onto the adjoining property, but shall be conveyed to the street per city standards. Okay, that's all I have, and Mike, are you going to be speaking? Did you fill out the card? Okay, so I'm not going to read your...
Well, that letter there is not to be
due. Okay. Oh, okay. Yes, wrong timing. Okay, let's hear from the case planner, Jale.
Good morning, Ms. Fuentes.
Good morning.
The project before you with the case number PVAR 2009-019 located at 2256 Hollister Terrace is the request for legalization of an outdoor covered kitchen located on the property line, which does not comply with the code requirements in terms of height or setback. The outdoor kitchen is just above 20 feet in height, where 15 feet is allowed maximum for an accessory building. The building has been constructed on the property line where a minimum 10 feet setback is required. The intent of the ordinance with regards to setback is to provide adequate separation between the two adjacent properties. And the intent of the ordinance with regards to the height and setback for residential zone is to prevent visual overcrowding, protect privacy, and limit noise impact. The outdoor kitchen is built on the property line. The lot is large with an area of 10,965 square feet and currently has an approximately 900 square feet area available behind the garage to provide an alternative location for this building where it would comply with the setback requirements. Although the southern and extreme western portion of the site slope, the majority of the site is flat, and the proposed structure built on the western property line can be constructed to meet the height requirement. No hardship could reasonably be established to allow the building to remain at its current location. The subject lot is relatively narrow and deep, but this is a characteristic which is not unique in this neighborhood. Many of the lots in the vicinity have the same size and shape. As mentioned above, there are currently alternative locations for this outdoor kitchen to be located. The outdoor kitchen located on the property line would be materially detrimental to the neighborhood, as it infringes unnecessarily on their property, on their privacy, and allows noise intrusion, both of which would be mitigated with the required setback, 10-foot setback. The granting of the variance would be contrary to the objective of the ordinance. Accessory building and structures are allowed in the R1R zone, but they are subject to compliance with the code requirements. Planning department staff has concluded that the four findings cannot be made in a positive manner and recommend denial of the case.
Okay. Did you have any conversation or communication with the neighbors to the left or to the right of the property?
I have received emails and phone calls, a copy
yeah, because
of
this
each.
One, this Allison Drucker is the one that's directly next to the
right
structure.
I, she called me and also she sent me the letter, emailed me the letter.
Okay. We have Marco and Garo from representing the property owner, so we're going to give you 15 minutes. You can share it accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Ms. Fuentes, for the record, my name is Marco Brambile. The address is 109 East Harvard. And with your permission, yes, that's what we would like to do together with my partner and the applicant, Mr. Nazarian. We will present the case to you. Mr. Nazarian will address more of, in detail, some of the specific items that you mentioned in your review. Essentially, we are in front of you here today because the gazebo is on the property line. For the record, the house, the garage, and the deck were built legally. The deck actually was built in 2002, and at one point when it was decided that the gazebo by the pool, by the way, that was the purpose of that, to be close to the pool and not in the back of the garage, would be ideal location, would be on that permitted deck. And yes, it should have gotten a permit prior to construction, but that's essentially why we are here today. You know, had we applied for that prior to the construction, we would have then applied for a variance for that very same location, because that is the location which is providing shade right by the pool area. Now, there are a few things I would like to mention. The property is extremely deep. The property is narrow and long, so it is pretty much at the end of the property. It is totally open on all four sides, so it is actually a gazebo. It's not an enclosed room area. And although the staff is calling an outdoor kitchen, yes, it has good kitchen facilities, but the intention here is, and again, the use is like a shaded area by the pool, and that's basically what it is. There are a few components that I would like also to mention. The addition of the gazebo, save for the fact that it is on the property line, it's not adding a habitable space to the property. It's not adding usable rooms area or either sleeping or living areas. So this is basically a structure open on four sides. There is one more thing about the height. The height of the actual structure is someplace, you know, between 13 to 14 feet. The only reason there was mentioned by the report that it is 20 feet, obviously, is because it's measured from the lowest point of the neighboring property. So the actual, you know, the image when you say 20-foot gazebo, it sounds like a, you know, huge structure. In essence, though, the 20 feet is measured from the lowest point, from the lowest point of the neighboring property. With that in mind, maybe I should turn over to Mr. Nazarian, who will address some of the technical aspects.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, I want to continue the Marco's discussion. When we even received the letter that it mentions 20 feet 2 inches structure, which is correctly mentioned because it's calculated based on the code or how the ordinance is written, and having discussion with the different people, even me, by knowing the code, I thought, Ben, a 20 feet high structure, it's a huge one. For that purpose, this past Saturday, we got an outreach with the neighbors. We invited them to come and to see the structure by themselves and to find out, to see what it has been built. And in the same day, just few of neighbors, they came. And one of the letters that you mentioned you received from 2248 Hollister Terrace, Mr. Frank Tortorelli, that was opposing there. Mm-hmm. Saturday when he visited the site, and he saw that, you know, even he mentioned, where is that 20 feet structure? He did look around, and in a Saturday he signed a petition that's supporting the project. He's not opposing anymore, because by the letter he was scared 20 feet high structure, but when he saw that, he has no opposition for the project. I did review the comments of the different departments. Of course, after this variance, if granted, we have to apply for a building permit, and we have to comply with all the building codes. And the fire department concerned about the high fire hazard area, I know that the structure is not complying with the high fire hazard area structures and construction, which it's the eave protection that we will comply with that, and we will upgrade the building up to the code. And I would like, I don't know if you have there or not, but I would like to submit all the letters that we received from the neighbors that they supporting the project, and to give a visual image of the what we are talking, I prepared a map to show that you chose the property, and these are the letters that they support.
How many do you have here, Dina? How many letters do you have here?
It's about 18, 19 letters.
Okay. Yeah.
And this is a map with just showing the subject property, and the lots colored green, it's the ones that they support the project, plus this one, we did receive the letter this morning, which I wrote down supporting the project, which is not colored.
Do you want me?
Visually, you can see that a lot of the neighbors, they support the project, and they don't have objections, especially after visiting the site on Saturday. And I want to quote here what I heard for this construction when I heard the concern about the privacy and the structure on the, you know, this gazebo on the property line. It has been told to me that the owner of the this lamp property, during the construction, the next neighbor, adjacent neighbor that they are opposing now to the project, before the construction, there was no wall separating, you know, visually, to give a visual privacy to the other neighbors. They were very happy to have that, you know, 4 feet, 4 feet and a half feet high wall, because it gives them the privacy. And in that time, it has, I'm quoting, I wasn't there, but in that time, the neighbor was happy with this structure because it was giving more privacy to them. And because even in the past happened a few times, the dog of the Mr. Koshakarian jumped to the neighbor's house, but now it's blocked visually, and even the privacy of the neighbor is not disturbed. Actually, it's improved. And as the Neighborhood Service Center code reinforcement comments, yes, they are code reinforcement cases, which one of them is to get this structure legalized, and the other violation was an overgrown tree that has been taken care. And hopefully by granting this variance application, we will clear the situation with the Neighborhood Service Center. And just I want to add what Marco told previously. The purpose of this gazebo is to give a service to the pool area too, you know, the shade area and the sitting area, or having a drink or just a barbecue close to pool. It's serving the, you know, more than to having a accessory building behind of the garage.
Are you going to go through the four findings? You haven't addressed any of the four findings. Beside the neighbor's support, I'm still waiting to hear about
Band of findings.
The you know, what's the hardship? What's stopping you from moving it 10 feet inside? And it's like what the case planner said.
The issue is the location, the hardship, as we told, it's a narrow lot, and the pool is located next to the garage, you know, garage building, which to giving, you know, each building, each area has a purpose how to serve or how to be used. So this gazebo purpose is to serve the pool area, because that is the outdoor amenity, you know, having a pool and this, you know, sitting area or shade area to sit when it's the summertime when the pool is getting used, having a shaded sitting area, that is the purpose of the, you know, the project. And the hardship is if I move the, as Jale mentioned, in the back of the garage building and, you know, keeping the setbacks, it will lose that purpose of the serving the using the gazebo. And it's a hillside area, and the height issue, the, you know, it's almost flat, but exactly in the back of the, you know, in the back portion of the property, which is sloping down, you know, that it creates, you know, it gives the height problem, which that the slope, it's a kind of the hardship that, and as I mentioned, the granting this variance, I thought it's an improvement to, you know, to give the privacy to the neighbors, you know, and having that structure which is closing and keeping the, even the, you know, visually access to the neighbor's property.
Anything as far as what do you think is unique about the property?
The uniqueness of the property, it's a big lot, but it's a narrow lot and there is no room, and the back portion, it's a sloped, you know, I can't put the building in the back of the property.
Okay. Anything else you have?
That's it, no.
It's still green, so you can go keep talking.
I don't have that much
to ask. Maybe I'll hear something that I've been wanting to hear. Okay. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Peter Thompson?
Hello, I'm Peter Thompson. I'm a neighbor. I live at 2257 Hollister Terrace.
Are you on the other side of the
which
street?
Which is across the street.
Okay.
I visited the site. It's visually pleasing. I have no objections to the construction. I think it's a benefit to the neighborhood. The narrow lots are a problem. We have a narrow lot. And when we expanded our kitchen, we applied for and received a variance as well. In our case, the house itself was not within 10 feet of the property line.
What's the width of the lot, Jale? Is it 61 or 59?
It's 50. I have to make sure I'm giving you the right information.
I know, it looks
it's 51
good.
Feet by 250.
Okay, go ahead. Thank you. Paul Chamberlain.
My name is Paul Chamberlain. I live at 2604 Hollister Terrace. I am a member of the Board of Directors of the Glen Oaks Canyon Homeowners Association and also a homeowner in the canyon since 1969. 4 years ago, our family embarked on a very, very large construction project renovating our home. First thing we did was go to the city, find out what had to be done, what was required, and how we were to proceed. I have some questions for the builder and for the homeowner. Number one, how and why was this built without a permit? Was it done in secret? Why wasn't any of the home inspectors that patrol the canyon working with the various people able to tell that this was being created? Number two, how can you bring this project up to code if it already sits on the property line and if it exceeds the height? Were you going to cut off 6 feet? Are you going to move it? The project already exists. I think the bigger question and the bigger thing you have to think about with regard to this particular project and a number of other ones are people can't continue to flaunt the laws and the rules of the city of Glendale in terms of building and safety. You've got to come to the city first. You can't run roughshod over the laws and the requirements and then apologize when it's already built. I'm asking you to deny this and send a message to the others in this city who may decide to build first and then apologize.
Thank you very
much. Thank you.
Jerry Rankin.
Yeah, I'm Jerry Rankin. I live at 2423 Hollister Terrace. I, like Paul Chamberlain, am a member of the board of directors of the Glen Oaks Canyon Homeowners Association. Let's imagine a situation in which a person living on Street X wants to build a structure that he suspects would violate city ordinances. Nevertheless, determined to build a structure on his property, he decides to construct it without applying for a building permit. He realizes that the neighbors might object because the project would negatively impact their property. But he reasons that if the city did not get involved, the neighbors wouldn't learn about his project until it was well on its way to being finished. Then the structure would be a fait accompli. Once he spent a lot of money, time, and sweat on it, surely nobody, not even the city, would have the heart to make him pull it down. Let's assume that in our story, that's exactly what happened. The neighbors are bitter, and city officials grumble, but the structure is allowed to stand. Now, let us assume that others in the neighborhood want to improve their properties with various questionable projects, and that they become aware of what transpired on Street X. Is it too much to think that some of them would be inspired to proceed with their projects without applying for building permits, just as did the man on Street X? Once this scenario were repeated several times, the city planning department would find that it had lost control of residential construction in the city. Now, I don't know whether Mr. Koshkarian, in the case today, made a deliberate decision to violate city ordinances in the way and for the reasons I have described in this story. I don't even know whether you will determine that his outdoor kitchen or gazebo violates city ordinances. Still, isn't it possible that regardless of Mr. Koshkarian's thought processes in approaching the project, whether innocent or not, his neighbors will extract the same lesson as the neighbors of the man in my story? In my view, and in the view of many others on the board of directors of the Glen Oaks Canyon Homeowners Association, the decision you must make is whether the outdoor kitchen, as it stands now, violates any city ordinances, whether in fact plans for it would have been disapproved if they had been submitted to the city as required by law. Then, if you decide the structure is not in conformity with city law, you must require that it be torn down, or at a minimum, you must require it to be modified to bring it into compliance. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mike Mohill.
Mike Mohill. I live about a quarter of a mile east of this project, and I knew nothing about it until I happened to speak with the immediate neighbor, Angie, who I notice is not here this morning. I can only imagine that she's very upset, because when I spoke with her about it a month and a half ago, she said, "Mike, look at this monster they've created for me. And it's all in violation of the city codes." And I saw the sign in front of the house of this code violation, and I started asking questions. It's all about the law and the letter of the law and the intent of the law. If the city has spent all the money and resources to create laws, and then we go ahead and grant variances after the fact, what is the message we're sending to the public? Go ahead and build, do what you want, and then later on, ask for a variance. It's fait accompli, but that's not right. This neighbor probably knew the law. If he didn't know the law, I'm surprised. After all, We live in a middle-class neighborhood, and ignorance of the law is no excuse. No permit was asked for this proximity of the neighbor. Okay, the fire department said this is in violation. After the fact, people want violation of all city codes. This is not a hillside piece of property. It is in the hills, but it's not in the hill right next to it. Okay, all the lots in this particular area are long and deep. And the gentleman who purchased this house knew it when he purchased this house. If he wanted a wider house, he should have bought a house that had a wider lot. But the results he created is horrible. To infringe on the rights of his immediate neighbor is horrible. Who has the greater right? The neighbor who has violated the law or the neighbor who has not violated the law? Who has lived in this particular house for many, many years as a peaceful neighbor and respectful of everybody else around them. My two previous speakers, Mr. Chamberlain and Mr. Rankin, I feel the same way they do. The neighbors who say, it's okay, let this gentleman violate the law, they don't live right next to this piece of property. They probably live across the street or down the street. If it affects you personally, I would be complaining. I have a neighbor right now, just a sidebar, that has oak trees and sycamore trees, right on the property line. And he thinks it's okay to have his trees into my yard because he's protected by the indigenous tree ordinance. So he's infringing on me, and he says, tough love, Mr. Mohill. I have the law in my favor. Now, we're not talking about trees this morning. And what rights of neighbors. Thank you.
Thank you. Mercy Puwen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Mercy Puwen, and I live in 2261 Hollister Terrace since 1971. And I have been neighbors with the Koskarians for like 10 years. And I know these people are nice and quiet people. I have seen their project, and it's like what Mr. Thompson said. It's very pleasing, and it's very nice. It's a very nice project, especially for entertaining. And I don't see anything wrong with it. So I'm in favor with their project.
Okay. Thank you. Shake Khosrovian.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I live in Hollister Terrace. It's 2230 Hollister Terrace. And we are not too far from their house. And Saturday, I went there and I looked. It's just a small, not too high area for summer rest and having guests and having your family having a picnic or enjoying your time in the summertime. I don't know. I don't see anything wrong with it. It's beautiful.
How many houses away are you from this?
Four houses down.
Four houses down. Okay. Thank you.
That's it.
Susie Koskarian.
Good morning.
Morning.
I reside at 2256 Hollister Terrace. And with all due respect, I disagree with Mr. Chamberlain's assumption about the structure having been being built in secret, because it was not built in secret. Our neighbors were very well aware of it, especially Mrs. Allison at 2250 Hollister Terrace. And on several occasions, I have had conversations with her. And during the while this project was in process, she actually did ask us to level the wall to put it up a little bit higher. And Jalay earlier stated that the purpose of the setback was to prevent us or any resident from invading the privacy of surrounding neighbors. And this structure, this patio, does not in any way invade the privacy of any of the surrounding neighbors. It is not materially detrimental to the public. And I have read and reviewed Allison's letter, and in the letter she did write, and she also told me this several times in conversations, that she does not want this structure brought down, but she just wants minor adjustments to it. And as she should be, or states that she's the most affected by this project because it's on her property line, she does state in her letter specifically, and she has told me various times, that she doesn't want it brought down, that it's beautiful.
I would prefer you talk about your... I cannot take documentation or conversation by another person.
Okay,
so
I will...
This is a fact-finding hearing, so I want to hear from you, not from what your neighbor...
Yeah, I just wanted to clear that, because earlier when you said that she opposes it, I just wanted to say that
I have
the
letter on file, so that's what we're going by.
Also, Mr. Nazarian stated earlier that we had a presentation on Saturday on site, and we had visitors, we had neighbors from the neighborhood come and see the patio. And I just wanted to bring to your attention that one of the neighbors that opposed came out, they saw it, he absolutely loved it, and he changed his mind.
Yes. I noticed that the letter was dated September 25, mm-hmm. and last Saturday was when you had the neighbors come into the house, right? Are you related to Gevorg Koshkarian?
Yes, I'm his daughter.
Daughter, okay. The owner's name was reversed, so it says Koshkarian Gevorg. I didn't know which one was the first name or the last name. So. Gevorg. Go ahead.
We purchased this house in 99, and the property was, it was almost a jungle. There had been nobody living there for years. We've done major remodeling. It's increased the value of surrounding properties, and this patio is in the backyard. It does not affect anyone in the neighborhood. It does not invade anyone's privacy. And one more thing earlier, Mr. Nazarian was telling you for the hardship. The hardship situation where the patio is built, we have two huge pine trees in our backyard. And when Jalay said we have about, I believe you said 900 square feet of space, if we move that patio to that 900 square feet area, the 900 square feet area she's talking about consists of two huge pine trees that were there when we purchased this property. And the reason we built it where we built it was not to violate anything. We did not. It was because it's a fire hazard, and we believe that if we built it right by the fire, it's a barbecue area.
Okay, you're going to have to wrap up.
We felt that if we built it in that 900 square feet that she was referring to, there's two pine trees. We can't cut down those trees, and we just thought it was a fire hazard, and it's
okay,
not safe
good.
For the
neighbor. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Garine Abajan, followed by Marita Vartanian. I should have taken your case first. I'm sorry.
Good morning. I reside at 2262 Hollister Terrace, and I'm two houses down. And I'm really sorry the gentleman left who was talking about the monster, because I am Angie's neighbor on the other side. I have gone to my back lot property line, stood on a table, and I can't see the structure. So I don't think a structure two houses away can be labeled as a monster. On the other hand, the property next to me does have three garages that are built there right near the property line. So
can you point which one is your house? I'm just interested.
I'm the one with the angle pool.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so I'm directly two away. I've stood on a table, on a big round table, and I'm a pretty big woman, and you cannot see the patio structure from my house, right at the wall that adjoins my property and Angie's property. So I don't see how it could be a monster of a structure that was built.
Thank
And I'm all for it. They've done enormous upgrades to this property. So I'm hoping it's bringing up the property value of the area.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Marita Vartanian. Excuse me one second. Susie, when did you buy the property again? 1999, so 10 years ago. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Marita Vartanian. I am living in Glen Oaks, exactly back, a neighbor in from back, and we can see very clear, but just I want to tell you, they make a very nice and cozy barbecue area. It's not too big. It's not, I think it's not bother nobody because it's very nice. That's it.
That's it?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Is there anybody else here who would like to speak in support or in opposition to this application? Seeing none, closing comments, Mr. Nazarian?
Just I want to add here that this violation, it has been not done on purpose, maybe because of lack of knowledge and because of trusting, you know, contractors that they tell, I will take care, I will do everything by code, there is no problem. And I know that the structure by fire and the building code had some violations or doesn't comply with the building or fire code. But after granting this, of course, we have to apply for a building permit and we will, you know, provide, you know, we will comply with the building and the fire code as it's needed to pull a building permit. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to go ahead, take this case under submission, and thank you all very much for coming. Our last case is PUP 2009-003. Location is 324 Pioneer Drive and 633 North Central Avenue. Is this a different or the same property?
It's the same property as we did.
I know, I remember this. Okay. Applicant is Rodney Khan. Property owner is Marjorie Rhodes, LLC, and case planner is Gevorg Nazarian. This is an application for a parking use permit to use the parking lot located at 324 Pioneer Drive as a non-required parking lot for the office building located at 633 North Central Avenue in the R1250 PS medium-density residential with parking structure overlay. Described as Lot 14 of Pioneer Investment and Trust Company's Glendale Place Tract. And I guess it's all the same comments we had from the previous hearing. So, Gevorg, could you tell me what's going on with this project?
Good morning. Thank you. As you mentioned, the case number is PPUP 2009-003, located at 324 Pioneer Drive. Proposal is for a parking use permit to allow the parking lot located at 324 Pioneer Drive to be used as non-required off-site parking spaces for the office building located at 633 North Central. There was a setback and a standards variance approved not too long ago, July 2nd of 2009, to allow the use of the property as a parking lot because it was being used for 30 car spaces.
Oh, now I remember. We said we will determine if you need a parking use permit. Okay.
So determination was made that they need a parking use permit.
Okay.
Obviously. So
thank you for coming back.
New parking is for 18 spaces. It's got variance for setback and wall and all that. It meets all the other zoning code except for the ones that they got variance for. Staff believes that all the findings can be made in positive manner and recommends an approval of the proposal with a condition.
Mm-hmm.
As Code Section 30.32.160.B4 requires, all unused areas in the parking lot not used for driveways, maneuvering areas, parking stalls, or walls shall be permanently landscaped with suitable materials. Staff recommends that this be included as a condition because on the, I think that's the east side of the parking lot,
mm-hmm.
there are the triangular shapes abutting the property line that, as you can see on the site plan, they're not landscaped as they are on the west side. And staff recommends a condition of landscaping those properly as it is done on the west side.
Okay, great.
Because it is just a code requirement, and they're not asking for a variance on that. So other than that, staff supports the project and thinks it could be done well. It is fairly close to the 633 North Central address. It's about no more than probably 200 feet away. The pedestrians don't have to cross any streets to get from the parking lot to the building. It's a better use of the lot overall. So
I know I parked there. Okay. Thank you very much, Giberg. Mr. Rodney Khan.
Good morning, Ms. Fuentes and staff. My name is Rodney Khan. My offices are located on North Brand Boulevard in the city of Glendale. You're right, Ms. Fuentes. This is actually a continuation of the entitlements
that we sought
a couple months ago for a non-required 18-space parking lot that's in the parking structure overlay zone, which that zone allows for both parking structures and surface parking lots, as you know. The request that was previously asked for and was granted, and as you mentioned, mm-hmm. it was kind of up in the air after that hearing as to whether we required a parking use permit or not, and obviously we're here today because the conclusion was we did. A couple comments I wanted to make, though, in terms of if you look at the photographs that's been provided or if you look at the screen, we do have a number of parking accessories or parking type uses around us. Directly to the north of us is the 6-level parking structure which serves Unum Provident Building, the 655 North Central Avenue building. To our south is parking garages just south of the alley. We have an alley and then south of that is parking garages. To the east is surface level parking lots, and to the west, if you recall last time, it's a 3-story apartment building, mm-hmm. but the ground floor of that apartment building is for parking only. Right. There's no residential units. What I'd like to do, I'll briefly go over the findings as it relates to the parking requirements. I'll compliment Gavorg that he supports the application, but we do question in terms of the condition.
Oh, sir.
So it can't be that easy and simple. The first one is the off-site parking, a permitted or conditionally permitted use in the zone. It's a permitted use, as I mentioned. Second are the off-site parking spaces located within 1,000 feet. We're actually about 175 feet. And as Gavorg mentioned, we're on the same, we don't require crossing streets. It's on the same side of the sidewalk, both from the alley and also Pioneer Drive. Is there a current or tentative parking lot lease? No, there's not. The owners of this property, they also own the medical office building at 633. They own the medical office building south of that. In fact, they own the medical office building across Central Avenue as well. So they own a large majority of that property in the area. Explain how the off-site parking will be available to the use and that no substantial conflict will exist. This 18 additional off-site parking spaces, once again, are non-required spaces. They're used exclusively for the 633 North Central Avenue. No other businesses use this parking, so it's not being shared by a number of the buildings in the area. As it relates to explain how access to the site is adequate, we have access both off of Pioneer Drive and to the alley to the south, both for vehicular and pedestrians. So that should satisfy that. And it will also explain how the design, location, size, and operating characteristics of the proposed off-site parking are compatible with existing and future land uses. The only land use on the site is parking. We have introduced or incorporated, as a result of the variance request, landscaping on the west side, which is where the residential properties are. As it relates to other uses in the area, this will actually benefit because we're taking parking off of the street and putting it onto private property, which typically is a good thing. In terms of how are the off-site parking spaces in close proximity, I say that this existing lot has been used for parking purposes for the past 5 years. Just talked about the additional landscaping. And is valet parking proposed? The answer is no. Now, as it relates to the conditions of approval. The condition of approval, as I pulled off the staff report, it reads, staff recommends including conditions requiring that the triangular-shaped unused areas that are adjacent to the parking stall to the east be landscaped and a covenant agreement for the off-site parking be provided. I'll start with the covenant first, and then I'll go back to the landscaping. As it relates to the covenant, this is voluntary parking.
Additional parking.
Additional parking, non-required parking. If I open my code book and I was to go to the parking use permit section, it says the applicant shall provide evidence of a valid lease or a covenant. What we would hope for is because this is voluntary, we would want to have the least restrictive, the least cumbersome on the property, so we would agree to and be happy to provide a lease, as is allowed in your code, but would not want to do a covenant, mm-hmm. which is the most restrictive. That's the first item. The second item, and hopefully that makes sense, the second item as it relates to the landscaping. Our lot size is 8,300 square feet, and as you know, 5% of it is required to be landscaped, the interior area, which does not include the landscape strip adjacent to Pioneer Drive. That would equate to 415 square feet of the lot being landscaped. We are currently providing 665 square feet of landscaping, which equates to 8% of the lot. So a couple hundred, 250 square feet more than what the code is required. The reason that we put it on the west side, when we originally had it on the east side, was because, there you go, because the residential apartment building is on the west side. And we could landscape, we can put in trees, we can put in shrubs and ground cover, and that acts as a very nice buffer to the residential to our west. To our east on our site is a block wall. And I'll provide you a photograph. Of if we were to landscape the east side of the site as well. It actually would not be visible because you'd have that wall there. It would be visible from a small number of people that are visiting the site. But once again, we already exceed the code requirement for landscape percentage. And I'm not sure what we're really benefiting.
We're just trying to make it look nice.
Well,
the board, we're talking about these triangles, right? This one and this one?
Correct.
Or, yeah, because this is already in. So,
if you recall from the standards variance requirement, we were to put in trash receptacles.
Right.
Those are the areas that we are looking at putting the trash receptacles out of the landscape area into those triangular mm-hmm. shaped. So from our perspective, we understand that the city would like to get as much landscaping as possible, but we are already exceeding the landscape right. requirement.
And I realized that, however, I remember about the trash location, and you're going to have to convince Gevorg because I really take his recommended condition seriously.
Sure.
And as a matter of fact, I was going to start with your case today, giving approval on the spot.
Right. It's very good.
Provided we agreed on the conditions, and I was going to use his findings. And
well, can we take a step back, if you don't mind? Mm-hmm. The first one, as it relates to the lease as opposed to the covenant.
I'm okay with, like you said, these are not required parking. These are additional parking to just serve the area. So give us.
Just for clarification, the reason why I put down covenant instead of a lease is because it's owned by the same owner. Thinking you can't lease something to yourself, you will need a covenant to with the city that you will be using the lot as parking.
They can lease.
If Either way.
Whatever will work and whatever acceptable will.
Okay, so the lease part we would.
That's okay. Uh-huh.
Okay, we're okay with. As it relates to the landscape part.
Maybe what we should do is, because I wanted to see the trash bins in there. If there's no more room for landscaping, then we can work it out. And like you said, you exceed the landscaping requirement by about 200-something square feet. So if you and Gevorg can work it out and Gevorg will come to me and say everything looks okay, then I can issue the decision. Darn. I wanted to start today.
Okay. Well, we appreciate that, and I'll certainly be happy to work with
Yes, I would just recommend you work with Gevorg, and
sure.
I'll wait to hear from Gevorg whatever you've agreed upon. Okay?
That sounds great.
And I was ready to issue a decision letter approving this today.
Well, hopefully we'll work it out in the next day or two, and you can do it real soon.
Okay, sure. Thank you very much. Is there anybody else here? Okay. No closing comments. Just work out with Gevorg, and Gevorg will let me know.
Great.
Okay, good. Thank you. I'm going to go ahead, take this case under submission, and close the public hearing at 10:55 a.m. Thank you.